So, Kristin, first, why don't we start with just you telling folks why C8? I mean, how did the devil we know? What was the genesis of this film?
So the genesis of the film was that the director that I'm working with on this film, Stephanie Selkdig, her first feature film was something called Tapped back in 2009, and that took on the bottled water industry. So it looked at the fact that, you know, there's now this plastic soup in the oceans because we're drinking so much bottled water. But another aspect of the film was the chemical in bottled water, BPA. And, you know, Stephanie got really interested in that after this film and wanted to explore an additional film that really just looked at how we regulate, or more accurately, don't regulate toxic chemicals in this country. And, you know, in order to make a film about that, you have to sort of find a story that has some characters to carry the issue. And so we had been looking literally since 2009 for something that would be provocative and interesting enough that people would connect with it, would connect with the characters. And back in January of 2016, so we've been working on this for about a year and a half, we read an article in the New York Times Magazine that sort of detailed the whole legal case surrounding C8 and surrounding DuPont and surrounding the community of Parkersburg, West Virginia. And we immediately all agreed that this was sort of our in to the larger issue because it's such a compelling story.
And so tell us a little bit about C8. I mean, I think we've certainly talked about it on this program. Mike Papantonio, obviously, the lead litigator in the case, but it has a tremendous story before it ever got to trial. Tell us, what is C8, and what was that the gist of that story that you heard and that you read in the New York Times? And we can talk about where you've gone with it from there.
Sure. So C8 is a chemical that's been around for years and years. I believe 3M started production of it back in the 50s. And it's a man-made chemical that is used in the making of Teflon as well as countless other consumer products. So it's found in stain-resistant carpeting and pizza boxes and fast food wrappers, and it makes things, you know, non-stick, things just sort of slide off of this chemical, or the application of this chemical makes things just sort of slide off, and, you know, it's made dental floss, firefighting foam, so they're just, like, endless products that you can name. You know, it's used in car washes, so it's really found everywhere, which I think is, again, a reason why we thought this particular story had such popular appeal, because, first of all, everybody knows the brand name Teflon. Everybody has a Teflon pan. You know, you can really relate to it. And so that is the chemical at play. And so basically the story that we read in the New York Times was about this community in West Virginia. So DuPont, which is one of the largest chemical corporations in the world, has a really large plant in Parkersburg, West Virginia called Washington Works. And they've been making Teflon at this plant, again, since like the 50s. So there are all these internal documents that show that dating back to the 50s, literally as soon as they started using this chemical in the application for Teflon, they realized that there were health effects. So they had, you know, there are all these internal documents that show that there were liver effects in rats, that there were issues with monkeys. Essentially every lab animal that they, or 3M, which was applying the chemical to them, did on lab animals, there were toxic effects. And essentially, it was just a decades-long cover-up. They just buried the information. They didn't report it to the EPA. And then it wasn't until the late 90s when a cattle farmer in the area who had sold a plot of his land to DuPont discovered this chemical, because he took a home video and he realized, and he showed that all of his cows were dying. Fish were dying in the stream. Deer were dying on the banks of the stream. So basically any wildlife that was coming in contact with this water, which had C8 in it, they were dying. So he contacted a lawyer, Rob Bellott, who is based in Cincinnati, and their teaming up put in motion sort of a legal case that has been going on since that time. So that's the late 90s. And then because of him, and because of this cattle farmer, and because of the attorney he hired, they eventually, through the discovery process, came to realize that it wasn't just about this stream, and it wasn't just about the workers who came in contact with it in the plant, that DuPont had actually knowingly been dumping this chemical into the drinking water supply of 70,000 Americans surrounding the Washington Works plant.
And we should say they were doing this knowing full well that they were supposed to burn this material.
Yeah.
3M subsequently got out of the business because they found C8 to be too dangerous to deal with and the potential liability associated with it. And like you say, it took about more than 20 years for the case ultimately to come to trial involving all the people in this area. And there was, there's a whole nother story, I think, too, you know, from a plaintiff's attorney's perspective, an independent council of epidemiologists who determined the increase in the incidence of diseases that could only be tied to the fact that this C8 had tainted the water. But let me ask you this. Now, you point out in the trailer of your film, and I should say, you know, folks, that you that you are raising money for this. So I saw the trailer over on your Indiegogo page. And I found it very compelling, frankly. But the idea that this is everywhere, how is it that C8 is everywhere? And maybe that's a slight exaggeration, but not really.
It's not a slight exaggeration. I mean, they have found this chemical in polar bears in the Arctic, in, you know, salmon in Alaska. It's literally been detected in the blood and organs of wildlife all over the globe. It's found in 99.7% of Americans' blood, according to the most recent CDC statistics. So it is everywhere. We get low levels of exposure through the consumer products that it's in. So through our Teflon pans, through, our firefighting foam. You know, I know this is a big issue on military bases right now because of firefighting foam exercises. Mm. But also, you know, it's just been pumped out of factory smokestacks for so long. So even if it isn't directly and maliciously sort of pumped into the drinking water supply as it was around Parkersburg, West Virginia, it's coming out of smokestacks. It's landing on our crops. I mean, it's been detected in apples and green beans. By one way or another, it's getting everywhere. So nobody is sort of immune to it. But I also think an important point is that this isn't just about this one chemical. For us, this story about what happened with C8 is an entree into the larger issue, and that is
well. Kristin, let's take a break there, because when we come back, let's talk about that larger issue. Like you say, C8 is just an entree into this world, which is, you know, a classic case and a really disturbing case of a company privatizing the profits and then socializing the costs. And by that, I mean making us all pay, in some instances with our health, some instances with our lack of clean drinking water, et cetera, et cetera. But we got to take a quick break. We'll be right back. Sam Seder, Ring of Fire Radio.
They wanted to believe that it was just people in the factory that were affected by all this. But unfortunately, they had clear information that the levels of exposure for people outside the factory were actually higher than the people worked in the factory. But when they determined, should we tell people outside the factory, they didn't. They kept it a secret. Their own scientists again and again, their own lawyers, in fact, told them, you know, we should tell people about this because they're drinking it in their water.
DuPont became aware that the chemical had seeped beyond its plant. and they wanted to figure out how far it had gotten. So a team went out with some jugs, plastic jars, and went to general stores and went miles downriver to collect samples. They didn't say why they were collecting samples or that they were from the company, but in testing these samples found that in fact the chemical had gone quite far from the plant.